Welcome to another Animation 1-to-1 from Squiggly.com. I'm Steve Henderson. In this episode, we meet Megan Nicole Dong, the creator of the latest Netflix animation TV series, Centaurworld, which streams from the 30th of July. Centaurworld follows a warhorse who's transported from her embattled world to a strange land inhabited by silly singing centaurs of all species, shapes and sizes. Desperate to return home, she befriends a group of these magical creatures and embarks on a journey that will test her more than any battle she's ever faced before. Our guest Megan has worked for features for Dreamworks and on TV series for Nickelodeon before being scooped up by the streamer to bring us Centaurworld, the musical cavalcade of muppety mayhem with a surprise around every corner. It's also filled with magic, sparkle, merriment and plenty of action and adventure. Before we get started, don't forget to subscribe to the Squiggly YouTube channel for more videos like this. And if you like podcasts, you can subscribe to us via your favourite podcast provider. Be a pal and leave us a nice review. Why not? Let's do that as well. And whilst you think of something lovely to say in the review, let's head straight over to the interview with Centaurworld creator Megan Nicole Dong. Thank you very much for speaking to Squiggly today. Congratulations on Centaurworld, It's a real roller coaster of a show, but I'd like to hear where the idea of Centaurworld came from, the spirit of the show. It's somewhat based on your own life experiences, if you can believe that. Is that right?
Yes. Yeah. Thank you. Loosely. I mean, the themes are anyway. Obviously, I'm not a horse, and I haven't. And Centaurworld is unfortunately doesn't exist in real life, but For me, I grew up, I'm Asian American, and I grew up in a community where there's a lot of emphasis on academic performance. And even though I had like a lot of creative drive, I thought that I really had to kind of pursue something that was more traditional or normal as a career path. And when I was a teenager and I was, and I went to high school, I was expecting just to take, you know, to excel in academics and all of that. But there was a schedule mix up and I wound up, the only extracurricular activity available to me was show choir, which I wasn't expecting to be in. And when I ended up there, it was a lot of sparkly dresses and singing and dancing and jazz hands and musical theater, which I loved to watch, but I wasn't confident in being a part of. So I was really nervous and felt like I was gonna not enjoy it. But over the course of that year, I just fell in love with it, fell in love with performing and really got into musicals and into musical theater. But more importantly, it sort of allowed me to learn how to express myself more creatively. And it gave me the confidence to pursue the arts. I kind of knew then that music and all of the rights brain side of me were things that I really needed to pursue as a career. And I ended up going into animation as a result of that.
Well, thank goodness you ended up in the wrong class, I think.
But as it relates to Centaurworld, I really wanted to tell the story of someone who was a character that was more, you know, serious or thought there was only one way of doing things, who wound up in a world that really kind of shook everything about her and made her realize that it was, you know, all these other, there were these other sides to her and meeting other characters that kind of changed her in that way.
Well, Centaurworld is a kind of a Wizard of Oz style fish out of water story, but it's pushed through an animation lens and it gives you the opportunity to do absolutely anything. So maybe we could talk a little bit more about the idea of a warhorse and sent to this insane musical wonderland. Your own personal work, obviously, on social media seems to poke fun at animals, particularly sharks and anthropomorphism. Can you tell us a little bit more about how the kind of, I suppose, the centaur bit of Centaurworld came into play?
Yeah, I love drawing in sketchbooks. That's kind of a thing that I would do on the side because you know, for most of us working in animation, we work on Cintiqs, we work digitally in some way, shape or form. And so I've always found doodling and drawing and kind of just doing things more analog as, you know, making comics and all of that was kind of therapeutic. And so visually, I knew that I really wanted to have something that felt more like almost a little bit more hand-drawn. Centaurworld, like it was designed to have like, there's almost like a marker texture and the characters look a little bit more, you know, doodly, I guess, like the lines and all of that. You asked about like drawing animals and all of that. When I was younger, I was passionate about marine biology and just biology in general. I love animals. I love drawing them. And I think their nature is just, it's just so inspiring to me. It's just, I find a lot of the way that animals naturally look to be fascinating and hilarious, or just the biodiversity of the world. I've always liked to kind of push that visually. And so it felt kind of like if we could kind of do anything in animation, it would be fun to kind of create a world that's just, you know, like you said, poking fun a little bit about, poking fun at the natural world a little bit, or just pushing things to interesting places.
Fantastic. This show obviously has dual styles. There's a kind of a gritty, the opening is like a kind of Masters of the Universe style, classic war setting versus this, you've described it in various releases as muppety, this sparkle-fueled magical land. How complex is it to manage two worlds from a storytelling and from a design point of view as a showrunner?
It was definitely challenging. We found the best way to go forward was to actually use two different animation studios to handle both of the styles. And it ended up being a lot of fun, actually, because we worked with Mercury Filmworks to do most of the Centaurworld, the kind of more squashy, stretchy, muppety characters, and then a studio called Red Dog Culture House in Korea to focus on kind of the action. But as the, you know, as the story progressed and we had these characters kind of interact more and more, both of these studios had to end up kind of animating some of the characters from the other side, which presented a lot of really fun challenges. And when we had to share resources and all of that, and it was a unique experience.
I suppose the show itself is a centaur. It's half of one thing and half of another. So there's a use of magic in the show. With magic, it can be used as this fantastic fun device, but it can also be something of a burden. How do you go about setting rules in a show like Centaurworld, which on the surface has no rules?
I think for the magic, when our main character Horace arrives there, I think magic is something that's new to her, but also the magic that this group of centaurs she meets is not particularly useful. I think that was the first thing we wanted to establish was magic in this world. Initially, anyways, it seems like it's mostly used for frivolity or for just really strange purposes. So I think we wanted to kind of turn that idea on its head a little bit, where we didn't want to just introduce, you know, the kinds of magic you would expect, which is, you know, like stuff that can be used for bigger purposes. We really wanted to introduce magic that was really very silly and character based.
There's lots of fun in the animation and in the music and the script and particularly the voice acting. How have you managed to kind of keep the energy up on the show?
I think we always tried to have as much fun as we could. There is so much to juggle, and it was a lot of, I think all of the challenges kind of kept us on our toes all the time. So there was never really a dull moment. So that really kept the energy up all the time for the whole team.
I can't talk about Centaurworld without talking about the music, which plays a major role. Without relying on parody or mockery in any way, can you tell us about the use of music in the show and how central it is?
Music was one of the highest priorities for me here. We wanted it to tell the story, and I wanted there to be a lot of songs in every episode, but I didn't want there just to be songs for the sake of having songs. We wanted each musical moment to really be narrative, to tell, to be character-based, and to propel the story forward. So that was really important to to kind of, for me to be in the, you know, in the writer's room, and my co-EP Dominic Bisignano, who also wrote a lot of the songs, for us to be there in the writer's room working with the writers. And we would, a lot of times we would go, you know, work on our demos and come back and either pitch them, you know, sing them to the writers, or just play, you know, just, it, there's a lot of back and forth, and that was a lot of the fun of it. And then our composer, Toby Chu, was also with us at the beginning. And instead of kind of just doing the score later, he came on board during pre-production, and we were giving him our demos. He was producing them. And just, I think working with other people on the music, and who also had a lot of like storytelling in mind, was really fun. Like when Toby would produce our songs, he would have the story points in mind as well. So sometimes if we were, like for one example, there are some songs that take place in kind of a forest environment. And so he would go away and add, I think he went to like Home Depot and made percussion out of like chopping wood, or making shakers out of like shaking, you know, like out of dried leaves. And so he was incorporating a lot of storytelling elements into the way we produced the music, which was really fun.
Netflix animation really seems to be the place to be at the moment. A lot of well-known artists and up-and-coming artists are being supported by the streaming service. Can you tell me more about working alongside, even if it's virtual, some of your colleagues? There seems to be quite a collaborative, collegial atmosphere, as demonstrated by is it James Baxter, who hosted you recently at Annecy as part of the Netflix event there.
I think that was one of the most exciting things, was kind of coming into the studio that's kind of being built at the same time as many of us were developing our project. So when I first arrived at Netflix, it was literally being, you know, the building was physically being built around us, and it was a pretty small group at the time. So it was really exciting and energetic. It felt like being at art school. You know, like we were being in one room and kind of developing one project and walking across the hall and talking, you know, James Baxter being there, or Glenn Keane, all these, and Matt Laisel, who's working on Battle Kitty, which will be coming out, I think, at a future date. But it was really exciting just to, there was a special energy there, because most of us have come from studios that have long history and have already, you know, have their kinds of brands or culture established, but to kind of be at the very beginning of something was one of the most truly exciting parts of being at the studio.
Maybe we could travel back in time to when you actually pitched the show. How do you pitch a show like Centaurworld?
Yeah, it's a difficult show to describe. You know, there's a lot going on, and for me, I think, having seen a lot of amazing pitches from other people like Jorge Gutierrez, and I think I recognized that the only way to pitch something like this for me was to actually make parts of it. So when I pitched it to the studio and also to colleagues and people that I was interviewing even to come on board, what I had ended up working on when I was developing this was worked on a Bible, but also I worked on a storyboard pitch for the first episode. And in doing that, I was also I wrote the first few songs. And so the pitching process was basically pitching it, you know, pitching a storyboard, doing all the voices. And I had like piano tracks on my iPhone, so when I would get to a song, I would just like their backing tracks. So I'd press play and then just sing all the parts. And it was kind of like the best way to pitch it, because it's so hard to describe. And if you say you want to make a show that is, you know, like action adventure, but then also it's, you know, this muppety road trip musical, it's a mouthful. But I think the only way to do it is to really show what it is. Yeah, like performing it seemed to be the best way to do that. And especially since so much of the influence of the show comes from live theater or live performance, I think that it was kind of the only way to pitch it to others.
Would you say that your own background in storyboarding and at other major animation studios has really helped you kind of develop that knack for conveying Centaurworld?
Yeah, I think that everywhere that I've worked has kind of prepared me for this. Like, it is a really ambitious story and an ambitious project. And I think I feel fortunate that I got to work at both at, you know, DreamWorks Animation working on features and at Nickelodeon working on series. I think I've learned a lot from my peers, but also having, you know, learning about how things work comedically for series, you know, like comedic storytelling and all of that. And then also learning bigger story structure stuff from working in features was really helpful for me.
Has streaming ushered in a golden age, would you say, for creatives like yourself and the opportunities to develop shows that might not have been possible even a few years ago?
I think it's a really exciting time. And I think with streaming, there are just so many different possibilities. You don't have to think about episode lengths in the same way or the format. There's a lot of freedom there. But also creatively, I think there's just so much more range that you can that a lot of the studios are looking for, because you don't really have to fit it into a specific, a specific mold, a specific formula. There seems to be a demand for a variety of different kinds of content, which I think, I can't imagine making this show anywhere else, really.
Can you tell us more about some of your favorite characters from the show and what we might expect for the future of Centaurworld?
I truly love all of our characters. Horse, our main character, played by Kimiko Glenn, is a character that I both relate to and have a lot of affection for. And for our herd of centaur characters, I love all of them. Wamawink in particular, I have a soft spot for, and the dynamic between Horse and Wamawink is something that I really love. So I love all of our characters, but I love the relationships they have with one another as well.
And obviously, voicing Glendale, the character yourself, that must have been an opportunity for quite some fun in the recording booth.
It was a lot of fun playing that character. I really wanted a character that was going to have a really extremely muppety sounding voice, so just that really pushed and bizarre kind of vocal performance that was really specific. But it was also a lot of fun because the things that the writers would throw at me were getting progressively more and more convoluted in a good way. So it was really fun to portray the character.
Fantastic. Well, Megan Nicole Dong, thank you very much for talking to Squiggly today, and congratulations again on Centaurworld.
Thank you so much.
Centaurworld streams on Netflix from the 30th of July, and if you're interested in more content from Megan, you can follow her on Twitter and on Instagram at SketchShark. Follow Squiggly on Instagram, Facebook and Twitter, like and subscribe to our YouTube channel for more animation videos, tell a friend about the work we do here, and as ever, for the latest news, reviews, interviews, podcasts and everything else from the world of animation, head over to squiggly.com.